Good morning, everybody, and welcome back to another episode here at Bearham Engines. Like I've said to you before, there is probably 80% of our viewers have not yet subscribed to the channel. So please just hit that subscribe button, the notification bell, and then you will be notified every time we do a video. We'd really appreciate that. Right, guys, so here's the Cosworth for Auto Dynamics. You can see we've gone through the cylinder head. So all those inserts now that have been put in, all been cut properly. The face has all been faced. As you can see, that's lovely. It's a really good condition cylinder head. All the bores have honed up with just under a thou tuck out, and they have cleaned up beautifully. Eighth thou off the head. So as I say, we're gonna have to tell James about that. And this is the crankshaft. Obviously, it had gone on one of the ends. I think it was this one, I think. But first of all, what we do is we clock the main and make sure the crank isn't bent. This has obviously been ground 0.25, so John has tried to grind the centre main to clean up at 0.5, but there is an area, although it's polished and you can't see it, there is an area here where it measures on the diameter probably a thou and a half, two thou under bottom limit, so that's no good whatsoever. And James isn't happy to use a sort of X-bent crank anyway, which I wouldn't be, so we're not going to use that, and he's going to try and get a new crank. But at least we've rescued the block and the head, and that can now go back to him. In the last couple of videos, we've had a few comments from people saying what has happened with the MGB. The one that we had back here, the smoking issue, and the one that we found out that the PCV valve was not very good whatsoever. That car has gone back, not quite sure what's going on with the garage. They seem to have a bit of an issue with us, but they were quite rude when we took the car back for whatever reason. It's almost like they're acting like we didn't do anything about it and we were trying our best to get out of fixing the vehicle under warranty, but that is certainly not the case. The customer rang up today and apparently the car is running absolutely fine now. Whether that is down to the new rings, I very much doubt it myself, or it's now got this valve on it and it's all running correctly. But anyway, not quite sure whether it was to do with the bore washing, which it evidently did before. One of the problems, apart from the smoking before, was the side covers that cover where the push rods are. The gasket was leaking on the breather side, but we sort of put that down to maybe the crankcase breathing a bit. So we've replaced those gaskets with the modified rubber ones as opposed to the cork ones. And apparently he said that the garage has got back to him and said that both of them are hosing out oil. So I'm not quite sure what's going on there. We're going to obviously get the car sorted for him, but I'm just sort of scratching my head as to why the modified gaskets could leak so badly. So apart from that, guys, I think it's running okay. So yeah, we shall see what this oil leak is all about. From the last video, as promised, Isaac has stripped the TVR V8. At this stage, we're going to just inspect it, measure everything, get back to the customer as to what we found, and then we're going to have a chat as to which way he wants to go about building it, whether we're going to put trick rods, etc. in there. So far, Isaac's obviously given it a good clean, and you can see by the condition of the back of the block, it's absolutely fantastic. Obviously been looked after well, this thing, or not done many miles. Doesn't appear to be much ball wear in there. Haven't measured them as yet. No watermarks and what have you. So that block looks really, really good. As do, at this stage, as do the pistons. The rings do feel a little sharp and the bores are slightly glazy. So I expect this has been running a little bit rich. Depending on the mileage, I think that Isaac said it's, the big end bearings don't look too bad. But I think the main bearings, a couple of them had sort of gone down to, yeah, you see that's gone down to the copper there. So whether there's fuel getting in the oil and it's sort of diluting it and it's wearing the bearings prematurely, I'm not sure. We're going to have a look inside the oil pump, although we'll obviously renew that. We just want to sort of get a good idea as to what's been going on. But at this stage, it all looks pretty good. It just looks like it's been over-fueling to me. So yeah, we'll have a measure up of this, guys, and then we'll sort of report back to you and give the customer a ring. Right, on the boring bar here, we have got a 701M block, which is the Lotus Twin Cam 1500, I believe. Now, this engine was done previously and hasn't done many miles, apparently, but it's all come to bits. I think head gasket failure is one of the problems. And on close inspection, you can see that this block has had liners in the past. They look quite sufficiently thick, the liners, although they've used a straight liner, which we, if we can help it, don't use anymore. But the liners seem to have shifted. So they're all about sort of 3 or 4 thou below the surface of the block. And once we've got this block clean, we've turned it over to see whether the liners have been pushed down to a step. Because I said to the customer, sometimes what can happen is they press it down, but rather than go right to the bottom of the step, they sort of sit on the edge of the chamfer in the bottom of the step, and over time they can press down to that, obviously leaving a sort of 3 or 4 thou step. But unfortunately, on close inspection under that, if I can get underneath and show you, they haven't even done it to a step. So those liners are just pressed in with an interference fit with nowhere to go down the bottom. So I said, you can't guarantee that these are not going to move anymore. So we're boring it out and we're going to put a top hat liner in this block and bore it to the pistons provided. In the meantime, we've got to balance the crank assembly. John's ground the mains. I think the big ends are all right. But Isaac, coming around now, he's just going to face the flywheel. You can see it looks pretty disgusting. So, you all right, mate?
You all right?
So you've just removed the dowels.
Yeah, just had to drill the dowels out through the back of the flywheel.
And we're going to give it a lick over. But I've showed you before how to face a flywheel, but Isaac's going to show you how we clock this in on the big lathe.
On the big lathe. Well, first off, we need the DTI.
So what we do is we sort of... You don't need much pressure to clamp it on there, do you?
No.
You can see we're on the ring gear there, but it's just light pressure.
Yeah, lightly held in.
Otherwise,
the jaws.
You go too hefty, you just damage the teeth on the ring gear. But
set that to zero. Not that it'll really matter at this point, but.
So when you're clocking, it's best to go as far to the outside diameter as you can.
Yeah.
It just gives you a bit more of an accurate reading when you're setting it up, doesn't it?
Yeah. And then obviously give it a little spin. You can see that's pretty far in on this one.
You see where the dial's going in and out. Look, that's a country mile away.
Yeah. And now it's sort of...
It's about 30, 40 thou out.
Yeah.
Not too disastrous. So all it'll do is you're finding the high point.
Yeah.
Just tap that back. It's a bit of a trial and error thing, this, really.
Yeah. Right, try that again.
So.
That's a bit more like it.
There we go, we're getting there now. So it's just a case of keep finding the high spots. So there we go, look, you can see when you spin that now, it's within a couple of thou, but that's all ready to face now. And there we go, guys. That crank assembly for the Lotus has all been balanced. You can see how well the flywheel has come up compared to what it looked like. It was a bit of a disaster. John has ground the main bearings, but the big ends are absolutely fine. So he's just polished those, and that is all done for the customer. But guys, the other job for the same customer is this 1500 Lotus twin cam. So it's the 701M block. Told you earlier about the liners dropping. We suspected that they were a straight liner with no ridge at the bottom for the liner to sit against, and those liners looked like they'd slipped. But what has actually happened, guys, we've removed two of the liners already, and having removed just the first one, we could see exactly what had happened here, and this is what we've had in the past. We had it a year or so ago when we built a couple of Cosworths for two brothers. This engine was all done, so they've spent the time and the money and the effort putting these liners in, and they are in fact a top hat liner. Although the top hat is not that big, it's still a top hat liner. I've measured the interference down there and it's not quite as much as it should be, but that is not the reason for the liner slipping. Well, it sort of is in a way, because you haven't got the right interference. But what has happened, and I think it's the same as what happened on that Cosworth where the liners slipped, They've left too sharper edge on the inside here. You see that? And what happens if you leave a sharp edge there, when you push the liner in on the very inside of the top hat, where the top hat meets the outside diameter of the liner, there's a bit of a radius there. And if you don't deburr that good and proper, that sharp edge is going to sit against the radius and give you a false bottom out of the top hat. I think that is what's happened. It's a bit of a schoolboy error. We've seen it plenty of times in the past. And obviously, it only has to sort of give a false impression and for the liner to sit up. So basically, the bottom of that flange is not sitting down in the cutout. And then when the block gets hot, or obviously they haven't given it enough interference, they have shifted and sat down in their home position. What can happen sometimes is if it pushes down too far, we've seen it before where it cracks around where the flange is. And unfortunately, guys, a lot of money's been spent on this engine, and that looks to be what's happened. We're just going to get the other two out just to verify that they are all the same liners. We can't assume anything. As you know, in this game, assumption is the mother of all F-ups, as they say. So we're just going to get those two out at the end, confirm our sizes, and then fortunately, we've actually found the liner by the measurements that I've got already. I think, wherever we are, I think that is the liner there that they've used. So it's a WCL22 EFL. That, going by the measurements, that is what they've used. So hopefully I can get another liner off the shelf. If not, we're going to have to get some liners made. So I'm going to ring Westwood in the morning, and hopefully we can get something that's slightly bigger on the outside diameter, or something that we have to modify, either the length or something like that. Not good, guys. Cost the customer a considerable amount of money, really, compared to what it should have been, because obviously that is going to be the reason for the blown head gasket. Just something as simple as just deburring the edge there good and proper can cause major engine failure, and unfortunately I think that's what's happened here. Well, guys, that is it for another video. Stay tuned for Friday's video. We've had another two engines come in, and one of them in particular is quite an exciting engine to get in amongst. So make sure you stay tuned for that. Like I've said before, guys, please click the link in the description below and head over to our website and see our new range of clothing over there. Very exciting. And if you haven't already, like I've said, please hit that subscribe button, like, notification bell, and we will see you in another one. Thanks ever so much, guys. Cheers.